call the planning commission to order. Pledge of allegiance. Pledge of allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I couldn't hear.
Sorry.
Hey, well, roll call.
Mr. Bentley?
Here.
Mayor Jarrett?
Here.
Mr. Mazur? Mr. Newberry?
Here.
Here. We have no changes to the agenda. Comments from the audience regarding agenda items. If there are any comments regarding agenda item, please come forward at this time. However, if you have a comment for either one of the public hearings, we request that you wait till that agenda item comes up. Any comments? Seeing none, we have one set of minutes from February 25th.
Move to approve as presented.
Second.
Moved and seconded, thank you. Any discussion, changes, amendments? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Yes. Mr. Stolarski had a comment he would like to make before we begin the meeting.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As any of the individuals in attendance can see, we are a commission member light this evening. We're normally a commission of five members. We have four members here. That would require passage to be the affirmative votes of three of the four present members. So if at any time before the vote on your item, you do have the option of asking your item to be tabled, when the next meeting we would have a full commission. Thank you.
We'll be light next time too.
Yes. Mr. Bentley would not be at the next meeting, so we'd be four members at that meeting also. So I guess you could ask for passage to her to be tabled to two meetings down the road. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We'll move on to pending a public hearing, 3003 Bainbridge Road, Stouffer Corporation. Clerk, do we need to read the parcel numbers on this, Lon?
No.
Okay. We have a public hearing on the lot consolidation and the street vacation. I will open the public hearing. Is there anyone who would like to speak on the public hearing for 30003 Bainbridge Road, Stouffer Corporation? Everyone sure? Okay, we'll bring it back to the table.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to ask the indulgence and ask the director please to show us what's being consolidated and where the street vacation is, just so the public has a clear idea of what we're talking about. Lost somebody.
Okay. Referring to the property at the northeast corner of Bainbridge Road and Harper Road, multiple parcels make up that site. The properties extend from here to here. There is a street that was part of a this is old Harper Road right here that was never vacated. Another street here, I believe, called Sharon Drive that was never installed back in the day when this was going to be a subdivision, evidently. And so the two streets would be vacated, and all the lots comprising the site will be combined. It'll bring it into conformance with the codes.
Just a question, too.
Mayor?
And also, the lot consolidation, that should eliminate the need for any further variances, correct?
Correct.
Since this will all be one parcel?
Correct, because the lot lines are going through the building, through the parking lot, and it would eliminate those need for variances.
So we first have a lot consolidation.
One more
is there
item.
Any question?
Yeah,
is there
one more item? With regards to the vacation, the city has already accepted a vacation of these streets by ordinance.
I'm not aware. Engineering.
I think that better be the case.
Engineering.
I believe we have approved that in the past, and it was never recorded.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any questions on the lot consolidation for either Mr. Franklin or for the applicant? Okay, is there a motion?
I will move to approve the lot consolidation for permanent parcels numbers 951270029513300 951-330-9, 951-330-12, 951-330-13, 951-330-14, 951-330-15, 951-330-16, 951-330-17, 951-330-18, 951-330-19, 951-330-20, and 951-330-19.
Could you read that again? I think you missed one.
I'll second.
I was very careful reading those numbers.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Palumbis?
Yes. Next item is the streetification.
I thought you were skipping the number.
No. I'll move to approve the street vacation for the remaining portions of Harper Road and Sharon Drive, which cross this parcel.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Thank you. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Palumbis?
Yes. Next item is item number 26150 Som Center Road, Paninis of Solon. We have a special use permit for two additional amusement devices and a memorandum from our planner, which states that there will be four amusement devices on the premises. And is there anyone from Paninis here? If you please state up, come up and please state your name and your affiliation.
My name is George Lonjak, L-O-N-J-A-K. My partner, John Ryerson, R-Y-E-R-S-O-N. We are the, John's the managing partner there, but we're two of the owners.
Okay, and if you'd like to just explain what...
Well, we have different amusement devices in the restaurant bar, which is the Golden Tee Golf Game, a jukebox, two trivia games are trying, bar top. They're not...
Yeah, do you have a copy of the plan?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, put it on the yellow rectangle down there, and the folks at home can see it. Thank you.
And John, if you could explain the location of the different devices, but just to make it clear, these are not the infamous tic-tac fruit games or gambling games of any kind. These are strictly amusement. You can't win any additional games, or there's no payout. These are, in fact, these are games that typically are played on cell phones now.
Any explanation where the games are? These are the two Mega Touch Bar Top video games. This is the Toy Taxi. It's a claw game that dispenses inflatable balls for kids. It's located by the front door. This is the Golden Tee. It's located next to the side door by the fire exit. None of the drawings are highlighted in green, and it looks, but they do not overlap the egresses in any way. There's plenty, the fire marshal's out of measure. There's safe distance in front of the doors.
Mayor?
So what are the two additional devices you're putting in?
Well, we've had these four games here all along.
Right.
And we have them through a vending company. They apply for the permit, and they give us the permit. We were unaware that we needed an additional license for the two extra games.
So it's just the four total?
The four.
Just to be clear, you're not asking for two additional?
No, no, no.
Just, okay.
No, Mayor, we've had these four since we opened 4 years ago. And unbeknownst to us, we were ignorant.
Okay.
To put it simple.
And then the director went in for lunch one day.
It's all right.
Okay.
All right. Are there any other questions? I'll entertain a motion.
Chair, I'd like to make a motion for 6150 Som Center Road at Paninis for the special use permit for two additional amusement devices.
Second.
Second, thank you. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Palumbis?
Yes. So this has been approved tonight. This does not go to, according to our assistant law director, this does not go to city council, so this is done as of tonight. It's approved, and you do not need to come back for anything further, except for Mr. Franklin is gone.
Just that the actual permits have to be issued to the building department. This is just approval for the building department to issue the permits.
So you should be in contact with you, Mr. Franklin?
Or Charlie Bochane, who is the chief building official.
Okay. Thank you so much. So we're not going to see you on St. Patrick's Day next Monday? Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
You may after the meeting.
Okay.
Moving on to item number three, which is 32811 Aurora Road Liberty Investment Group.
We have a maximum number of wall signs variance to permit two additional 12.65 square foot maximum sign area variance for a directional wall sign. And we have a freestanding ground sign variances, and we'll go through all of those at the time when the variance comes up. If the gentleman would like to please come up from Liberty Ford, please state your name.
Greg Bumbu, 32811 Aurora Road, Liberty Ford.
Good evening, how are you?
Good.
Rick Siegfried, RSA Architects, 10 North Main Street, Chagrin Falls.
We'd like to, if you'd like to put up a rendering for the, let's do the wall signs first.
Sure. So, I could pull it all out. We can go as in depth or as however you guys want to do it, but what we've done here is pretty much go along with the guidelines that Ford implements or expects when you do a new dealership. So we've got the logo up in the upper left-hand corner of the brand wall. Then they've got this entry feature that we talked about the last time we were here in terms of the architecture of that and the materials. And they put a smaller logo there. And these are the sizes they recommend. And then the same thing with the Liberty denomination. It tells you that this is Liberty Ford as opposed to one of those other guys. So that's pretty typical on this showroom piece. And then like we talked last time, a lot of times this service area be back behind the building, but our site constraints don't allow that to happen. So we need to identify the parts of the building where certain things happen. So we got a sign here that says service, because that's where you pull in to get your car written up between these two doors. And there's a much smaller sign over here that says parts. And I mean, so we've got 400 or 500 feet of frontage there, and we've got these five signs which go along with what Ford is looking for relative to their branding and the way they do new dealerships, and then just identification so that the customers, when they come on site, can identify with where they're supposed to be and what's supposed to happen.
I see the four signs. Where's the fifth sign? Because I can't see it on the left.
The emblem. There's two right there.
Okay, there you go. Okay, I couldn't see the one on the left.
That's fine.
Okay, so you're looking for a maximum number of wall signs variance to permit two additional and a 12.65 square foot maximum sign area variance for the directional wall sign. Where's the directional wall sign?
I'm sure that's the service one.
You can't really see it on the
here. Yeah, it's tough. So, I mean, that's why we think it's the right scale and proportion for the building. If we make it much smaller, you know, you're going up and down Aurora Road, it's going to be hard to tell what's going on. So we think we've got it right. It fits in line with their typical prototypes and what they do. And the parts is a lot smaller, but parts is not typically a real big part of the business.
Rob, is that okay with the color for the parts and the service, a different color? Is that okay with the planning department?
Yeah, I mean, that's more or less what we've been seeing on the elevations all along. The only thing I would point out is the elevation you're looking at there is not the approved elevation. It'll probably be an elevation of the building, I mean, that you'll be seeing soon, but the signs are correctly laid out.
Okay, any questions from the commission on this?
No.
Okay, so we'll move on. Do you want to move on to the variances, and then we'll come back and do the approvals there, or do you want to do them?
However you want to do it.
What would the commission like to do?
Let's go ahead. We might as well approve these.
Okay, let's do that. Let's do the wall signs then.
Right, then I will move to approve the maximum number of wall sign variants to permit two additional.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Druckenmiller?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Bulunas?
Yes.
I'll move for a 12.65 square foot maximum sign area variance for the directional wall sign, which is the one that reads service.
Second.
Second, thank you. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
Mr.
Yes. Okay. So let's move on now to the freestanding ground sign variances. We have a 37.1 square foot maximum sign area variance. We have a 3 foot 5 inch maximum sign height variance, a 5 foot 5 inch maximum sign width variance, a 10 foot minimum sign setback variance from the street right of way line, a structure color variance for Ford freestanding ground sign, a structure color variance for the body shop directional ground sign, 200-square-foot minimum contiguous green space variance. So let's go through all of these.
That's a bunch of stuff. Let me start here. I'm just re-familiarized with what's on site. So there is an existing monument sign out in front. It's currently 5'9" tall and 11'8" wide. It's 2.5 feet deep, and it's 67 square feet. And then there's another directional sign that tells you where the service area is, because the service currently, you go onto the site and enter from the side. And that sign is 2 10.5 tall by 7.5 feet long and 213 square feet. So that's what's there. We don't think we're asking a whole lot more than that, but I'll bring back around to that. Here's a sheet, and I don't think you're going to get to zoom in on this all that much, but here's a whole scale of the signs that these guys make, and they want you to pick from the group. What's currently there is closest to the second from the bottom. It's a little bit smaller, because this one is 11'2" wide instead of, I'm sorry. 12'2" versus 11'8". So we're just a little smaller than this one, but we decided that we're doing this great big new dealership, we're doubling the size of it, kind of really want people we want to make an impact, and I know you guys want to make sure we're under control while we make our impact. But we picked the next one up, which is 13'5" wide, so we're 21 inches wider than the sign that's there. I think that what we're probably going to talk about the most is that we're about 4 inches higher off the ground, because this base is pretty low, and this base, as you can see here, they kind of put this thing up in here, so. That is one of the other variances. There is the question of what this is all made of down here right now. I think Ford, they take a white aluminum, and that's what they do, because they're pretty contemporary. We're willing to entertain a discussion about using one of the other materials that's already been approved. We've got our fiberglass panel or our white Aris craft masonry that we could put it on that are already on the building and been approved. So that's an issue, and then we've also got a second sign over here, which just says that there's a body shop in the back. And that sign is 6 feet wide and 1 foot tall, which makes it, again, significantly smaller than this one right here, so I know it doesn't really work that way, but we think, again, this one got a little bigger, this one got a little bit smaller. And the same thing as far as the base, what that thing is made out of. We're not opposed to making it match a material that we already have on the building, which I believe is what one of the ordinances is all about. The 200 square feet of contiguous area, I'm trying to find the right drawing here. I mean, it sits inside of a long grassy area. The problem is, it's not real deep, so it kind of butts up against the pavement on one side and gets close to the sidewalk on the other side, but it's still in a grassy area that's probably pretty close to that. And then, there's one thing that I have to apologize for, is that I kind of missed something along the way, and there's one of the comments from the Planning Commission that the location of this sign doesn't agree with what we have already had approved, which is our streetscape plan, which shows a location for the sign. So we've revised our drawing, and I have copies of them here to give you, if it's acceptable to say, we'll put the sign where we always said we were going to put it, so we don't have to go through that exercise, unless you really want to. So, I mean, that's in a nutshell what we're doing. I guess at this point, we should probably entertain questions.
Yes, anyone from the commission have a question regarding any of the variances?
Rob, if they're saying they're going to put the sign where they originally showed it, then would we still need the setback variance?
Yeah, because it extends from the right-of-way to the parking lot.
Would it still be the 10 feet, though?
10 feet, yes.
Yeah, because they're supposed to be 10 feet back.
But that's where we are now.
Right, but that's why, okay, that's why I just wanted to make sure. I didn't know what you proposed on the, I know that's where you are now, and then you showed a plan, but what is the...
Correct. You're right.
The original plan, that's all I wanted to make sure.
We just want to do what we're already doing, but a little bit bigger.
Building on what the mayor said, Rob, is the streetscaping going to remain the same with the plans that they have proposed this evening?
Yeah, what Mr. Siegfried showed tonight, put on the screen there, shows the sign in the location that was shown on the streetscape plan, so you would not have to modify the streetscaping to approve the sign.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, A couple of questions. Mr. Siegfried, you said that you're willing to make the base for these two signs match the requirements of the code?
Yes.
So we're not talking about metal panels in Arctic White anymore?
We can get rid of the metal panels.
Yeah, so, Mr. Chairman, I believe what that says is that we are going to ask them to withdraw the two variances for the structure color for the Ford and the body shop signs.
Would you be withdrawing those?
The request for that variance? Yes. We'll go along with the ordinance and match the material that's on the building.
I will so move to accept the withdrawal of the two variances for structure color.
So you're withdrawing the structure color variance for the Ford freestanding body ground sign and the color variance for the body shop directional ground sign. Is that correct?
Yes.
I'll second that.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes. Okay.
Good.
So now we're down to a few less variances. Any questions, Mr. Newberry?
Yeah, I was a little concerned. The drawings that came to us, never mind the fact they're a little small, but they seem to indicate much bigger signs than what we're talking about. And so I have a whole lot less objection to the 200 square foot green space variance around the sign, because really you've got the Ford oval set off the edge of the sign base. So in reality, there's some green space around it. Whether that ends up being grass or planted is fine, but that helps relieve some of the variance.
Thank you.
And that being the case, then I'm ready to move for 37.1 square foot maximum sign area variance for the ground signs.
Second.
Move and second. Thank you. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion for a 3-foot, 5-inch maximum sign height variance.
Second.
Seconded. Thank you. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
I'll move to approve a 5-foot, 5-inch maximum sign width variance.
Second.
And seconded. Thank you. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
And I get to vote or move for a 10-foot minimum sign setback variance from the street right-of-way line.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Per engineering, can we add a contingency to that motion?
Yes, sorry.
This be staked prior to installation.
Right. Staked by a licensed land surveyor prior to the installation of the sign.
Excellent.
Second.
Second. Thank you. With the contingency?
Yep.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Poulos?
Yes.
I'd like to make the last motion for a 200 square foot minimum contiguous green space variance, please.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. Thank you. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Poulos?
Yes. You will be at the next council meeting, which is the 17th of March, and the caucus will be in right here in back of us where the caucus was this evening, and 7:00 p.m.
I'll wear my green suit.
All the signs will
You're
be
not
green.
Not as lucky as the previous applicant. You guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate all your help.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for your cooperation also.
No problem.
We'll move on to item number 4, which is 6445 Somm Center Road, Fifth Third Bank. We have three items. We have a structure color variance, a structure material variance, and a number of wall signs variance to permit one additional. Good evening, sir. Can you please state your name for the record?
Good evening. My name is Jerry Weber, W-E-B-E-R.
And you represent Fifth Third Bank?
I represent Fifth Third Bank. That's correct.
Okay. If you'd like to please show your rendering and explain the variances.
Okay. Right here, I'm just showing right now just to get oriented. Again, this is the site plan. You have Somm Center Road. North is up. And the building is here. There's some drive-through lanes in the back, and the ATM is that red square rectangle right there. That's where the existing brick kiosk is with the ATM in it. As I said the last time I was here, the brick kiosk is deteriorating, rusty. It needs replacing. And this time we've come in, and what the bank would like to see. And what this is, it's a freestanding ATM. without the kiosk, but around it is a, what's called a surround, and it's just some panels that go around the sides, the top of the ATM, and then the signage goes on that surround, because you really can't put signage on the ATM itself, because there's just really no room on the front. And that's where we want the signage is so when you're using the ATM, the sign is there. So that's what they have. This is made out of a metal, and it's painted. And then the sign is out of a vinyl that is cut out and an internally illuminated above the ATM. And I think the variances we're requesting are the structure color, structure material, and then the additional, one additional wall sign for the signage above the ATM.
I think my position is very similar to what it was the last time when you came forward, is that we had, the commission was fairly clear with regard to the fact that we had, as a city and as a planning commission, imposed some very strict standards on the Giant Eagle Plaza when they built, okay. Especially with the type of materials that they used. I know we had a development plan that the administration, city council, and the planning department had everyone sign and had to use certain types of materials and certain types of other items. And it's just basically what we're seeing tonight is very similar to what we didn't approve last time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very similar.
I think the bank thought that because we're making it smaller, there would be less obtrusive to anything.
I think the whole, it wasn't that the obtrusiveness, I think it was, the whole point was we wanted it to be the brick, mm-hmm. as it exists today, to match the brick behind that we had the developer put in, even around the dumpsters and around other items at the, we agreed with Echo to have those types of materials even around their dumpster surrounds and around all their buildings and everything else. We wanted a uniform look for the area. So I think that's what we were looking for with regard to this ATM. I'll take some comments from the committee. Commission.
Yeah, I appreciate the fact that you're looking at your old presentation when you came in, Mr. Weber, that was 101 inches maximum horizon length on that one, and now you've cut it down to 40 to make it, not as obtrusive. I'm looking at the picture from the last time you were here, and it shows the existing ATM sitting inside of the brick housing there with the nice colorful Fifth Third logo on top of that. But even the columns that are supporting the structure you drive under, all the columns, we wanted them to be in brick to be cohesive. And what have you. So that's why we, I think that I'm mirroring what the chairman says, that some kind of a brick surround around if it doesn't have to be 101 inches, but it could be, to house the ATM machine in there would tie the whole building together.
I see.
I think that's what he's trying to get at.
I guess I have a question, because I know that the building code says that building pieces or parts, building construction should be of these colors, but basically this isn't a building we're putting up anymore. It's an ATM with a surround around it. You can't go inside of it. It's not occupiable. And I know that, the fences around trash areas and sign bases and things like that maybe have to be brick, but my thinking is, and the bank's thinking is, that this might be a separate consider it a separate item rather than a building or part of the building that would allow this type of material and colors. If we were to go to the second alternate that I brought in.
Okay, before you go to the second alternate, Mr. Franklin?
Yeah, I need to answer that for the commission. It's a structure under our code. We have a very broad definition of structure on purpose.
Okay.
It has to be something, so it's a, if it's mechanical equipment, it's required to be screened from view. which if the city were to consider just to be mechanical equipment, we'd require that be incorporated into the building face probably or surrounded by evergreens.
Okay.
So it has to, the variances have to apply in this case.
Okay, understood. The second preferred solution would be just the ATM itself, which would be gray, which would be a kind of a, just like a limestone color or something like that, a stone color or precast concrete color, gray, and then the only portion that would be color would be a topper, which is a box that's set on top of the ATM itself, and that would just have the signage on it, the Fifth Third Bank on the face, and then the words ATM on either side. And I'm just asking the commission if this would be something a little closer that they might agree to.
Mr. Chairman, the I think this is heading a little closer to the right direction. It gets the color more towards what we would like to see in terms of the earth tones, which are, you know, grays, browns, greens, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
My concern remains for the topper, but I do have to say that this makes a lot more sense than the base plan, where the only people that could see the word ATM were the guys in the auto teller.
Right.
It never seemed to make a lot of sense to me.
Yeah.
I'm also... that this one shows the letters ATM on both sides. I wonder how practical that is. And then I was thinking how practical that might be, and then I realized, well, wait a minute. When my wife drives me up so I can take money out of the bank, then perhaps, you know, I can get in on that side because she's driving. Rather than backing through the ATM. Most people are approaching the ATM from the south side. So the sign on the south elevation makes sense because that would show you where the ATM was. If you're coming at it from the north side, then you're probably coming in backwards.
I follow.
Okay. Just a small thing. My concern, I don't mind so much the metal enclosed ATM. I guess I can understand that rather than trying to do it in something like wood,
mm-hmm.
or even stucco, which we could approve. And I do appreciate the color being there. I still am concerned about the topper and the rise. But I have to think about it some more.
Any other comments from the commission? As you saw tonight, we did have one. We had Liberty Ford here. Liberty Ford did agree to withdraw a couple of their variances. Now, and I know each application stands on its own merits, and each application is its own application, but they withdrew their two variances for the structure color variance for the Ford and for the body shop, and said they put the brick base in. I was just wondering if your company would be willing to do that too.
Well, I think if, and this is going on what I have seen happen in the past and whatnot, that these two solutions wouldn't work with brick. The one with the surround around it, that would be that one. And the one with the topper, we're not going to put brick on top of an ATM type of thing. So I think what the bank would probably do is just replace the ATM and the kiosk the way it is right now with the brick. Because I don't see how we can do brick, brick material with the two solutions, with the two proposals that I presented tonight, and make it look right. I mean, you know, brick wants to sit on something, you know, like ground or on a platform, something strong, but setting brick on top of an ATM, I don't think would look right in your city.
So you're willing to just keep the existing enclosure and put a...
If you vote tonight on, you know, you deny the first one, but then you vote on the second one and deny it, then the bank would probably go back and come up with something else. I'm not necessarily saying it's going to be one of these two, or it might be the one that we submitted earlier, but with the brick kiosk around it. Does that make sense?
Gentlemen?
Do you have the picture of the existing ATM?
It was in the package from 114?
I think so.
What material is the surround now?
The surround is like a normal, like the steel metal kiosk that I showed last time that was painted blue, only it's got what's called thin brick on it. It's
okay.
It's just laid up on the side.
Yeah, just glued on.
Correct.
Okay,
and
what threw me was the door.
Pardon me?
What threw me was the door. I was trying to figure out
there's a door on the side or the back, and that's, I mean, the bank would prefer this because it's more secure, because
yeah.
when Brinks or the tellers go out to replace the money, they unlock the kiosk, they take it in, they close the door behind them, and then they shut the ATM down and do their work and whatnot.
So why wouldn't you want that again now? Why are you proposing something
Because
else?
They're trying to get away from these kiosks don't, with the brick on and all that, they're hard to maintain and they don't last that long.
Right. Yeah, there's still a metal skin under there. And it doesn't really show very well in this picture, but there's rust evidence on the sidewalk, either side of the ATM itself. The ATM obviously is suffering the most.
It shows up on the bottom here, right at the ATM.
There you go.
The ATM is deteriorating.
Yeah.
Well, there's other areas of the actual surround that are just like that.
Last time my wife drove me up there. Okay. I guess my preference would be to continue to have this kind of a facade. I would not object to some adjustments to the signage. You know, if that was something that you wanted to do.
Which one are you talking about, sir?
Looking at the existing.
Oh, this one.
Yep. If it could be something as simple as replacing the ATM, the box itself, the money box itself, in the same kind of surround or in the same surround, I'd be fine with that. If it meant that you needed to do something to improve, replace, or enhance the elevation of the surround itself, I'd be in favor of that too. I am not inclined to look favorably on a metal surround around the metal kiosk.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
If I might suggest, from what I'm hearing from the commission, rather than going through the exercise of denying the applicant, once again, if the commission would maybe consider referring this to the planning department rather than doing planning here on the
mm-hmm.
on the fly.
So. I'd be, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent idea. I just wanted everybody here to have a chance to talk about it, too.
Do we need to vote on the variance, or can we just refer it straight?
I would suggest maybe tabling and referring the applicant to the planning department to maybe rework the plan and possibly identify other variances and variances that are not needed.
I'll make a motion to table.
And refer.
Refer.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? No discussion on the motion to table, so we'll proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Blumes?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And do you have Rob's contact information?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Thank you. Move on to item number 5. We have a referral from the council, which was originally a referral from the planning director regarding a proposed temporary event ordinance. Rob?
This ordinance would simply be a mechanism to permit short-term temporary events like promotional events, art shows, craft shows, musical entertainment, and such. The mayor's office gets lots of requests to permit these types of events. So obviously, they have been permitted in the city for years. This would provide structure and would codify the process. Basically, what the process would be is that a site plan would be submitted, cover letter provided, review the safety forces provided, and at that point, determination would be made whether to approve the event or not. It's more or less what happens anyways.
Okay. All right, we need to have a public hearing on this?
Yes.
There, first of all, are there any comments from the commission regarding the ordinance?
Not at this time. I think a lot, most of my questions got answered in caucus.
Okay, so I'll entertain a motion for the public, for a public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, and this will be scheduled for public hearing at our next meeting, advertised. Be okay with?
I'm going to have to check to see, do we have?
Does that need to be advertised, Lon?
Publish this in the news.
I mean, it would have to advertise.
Is there enough time?
It might not be, because it has to be in on Tuesdays, and it depends on how long you want it to run. Tuesday is the deadline. Today's Tuesday.
We typically schedule a public hearing for our next available meeting, like we did with a lot consolidation tonight.
All right, I can get it in. It won't be in until the next paper. It missed this week, so it'll be in next week.
Right.
Okay.
So we have a motion and a second for a public hearing. Any further? Okay, proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. Next item is item number six, a proposed zoning code amendment. We have the comprehensive revision of permitted uses, and we are going to have the same procedure that we had last meeting. We are going to have Rob go and speak on the office district and the commercial district. He's going to go through line by line and explain everything with regard to those two proposals. Then what we will do is we will have our public hearing. At the public hearing, you can speak on any issue regarding the proposal for the zoning code amendment, not just the two issues or two items we're speaking about tonight. You can speak about anything. And we will keep the public hearing open for our next meeting also, and we'll entertain more public comment at that time too. But anything can be discussed after the presentation by Mr. Franklin.
Okay, I'm not going to go through the whole spiel I've been doing the last two times, but just to remind you where we're at, we have finished up the residential districts. We're now going to be moving into the office and commercial districts. Tonight we'll go through the O1 district to the C5 commercial district, and then hopefully get through that tonight, and then at our next meeting, we would try to go through C6. I-1, I-2, and the prohibited uses, and that would finish up our review. The reason the C-6 is tied in with the industrial, because it's a quasi-industrial type district, so I would lump it in with that. Again, this is a draft, and be a few more, a little more interaction perhaps on this issue tonight, because there's some questions that I need to ask of the commission, just opinion type things. It shouldn't be too difficult, but anyways, we'll get started here. So starting with the office district. And I don't know if we could zoom in a little bit closer. I can move it up and down so people can see it at home.
Dr. Rob.
Okay, good. That's good. Thank you. So same keys we've been looking at before. The black wording is the existing wording. Red wording is proposed new wording. Anything that's struck through is something that's proposed to be eliminated. So I'm going to go through these one at a time. Not a lot of amendments to the O1 district because we've amended that district fairly recently within the five years maybe. Same general layout as the residential districts. Principal uses are listed first. It says the following in red, the following uses shall be permitted in accordance with the provisions of this ordinance. That's standardized wording. One of the things we're trying to do is standardize wording between all districts. I'm just going to read through the current professional and business office buildings, medical office buildings, laboratories, clinics for the treatment and aid of humans. I have here churches, synagogues, temples, and other places of worship, just again trying to expand the use and standardize the wording between all the zoning codes. Public and private educational facilities, including those devoted to general learning and religious instruction, trade and business schools, existing wording, federal, state, and local government buildings, existing wording, museums, existing wording. Sorry, I'll keep moving up there, apologize. Any use that is termed by the City of Solon to be substantially similar to any of the above listed uses. And we talked about that as a concept that's continued throughout the entire zoning rewrite. So that's principal uses, nothing major there. I don't know if anybody has any questions. Then moving on to accessory uses, current wording, which is struck through here, is proposed to be eliminated but restated down below. It says buildings and uses immediately and exclusively accessory to the uses permitted on site, provided such accessory uses are planned and developed integrally with and are necessary to the successful operation of the main use. That's not the standard wording that we're using in the code under accessory uses, so we're replacing that with any use that is customarily incidental and accessory to any of the above listed permitted uses as determined by the City of Solon shall be permitted on the same lot as the principal use subject to the provisions of this ordinance. All accessory uses except parking, fences, walls, mechanical equipment, and approved signage shall be wholly enclosed within the main building or other approved structure. That wording is actually in the zoning code now in different sections, but it's not in this section, so we're just standardizing the wording. So any questions with accessory uses? Then, according to our standardized format, you have primary uses, accessory uses, and the prohibited uses. This basic prohibited use is going to be common through all the commercial districts, and what it says is prohibited uses within the O1 zoning district shall include, but are not limited to, those listed below. This list shall be considered to be supplementary to item A, principal uses, and item B, accessory uses of this chapter. And it says residential use of any building or premises. Obviously, in the office district, you don't want residential structures. The commercial retail use of any building or premises, except as an incidental and minor component of a listed principal use in accordance with the provisions of this ordinance. A dentist's office might have some small little area, perhaps, where you'd have a little bit of retail, but very, very minor and not the principal activity. Any use is determined by the City of Solon to pose a general nuisance or an imminent danger to the health, safety, and welfare of the general public. That's boilerplate language that you've seen before under this review. Any use is determined by the City of Solon to be substantially similar to any of the above listed prohibited uses. Again, boilerplate language. So if you have no questions on that, I'll move on to the office O2 district. The O2 district's only, show you on the map here real quick. The only O2 district is at the corner of Cochran Road and Aurora Road. So it's right here where the Parkview Federal building, now going to be the Tarquette corporate headquarters building, is located. And there's a reason I'm bringing that up, because I'm going to suggest an amendment to my amendment that came after this was sent to you. So the wording is, as you recognize, principal uses is the heading. Following uses shall be permitted in accordance with the provisions of this ordinance. Below that, in black, struck through, professional and business offices, medical and or dental offices for the treatment and aid of humans. Those are not being prohibited. They're simply being restated in the standard format here. So it's saying offices, including those for professional, business, real estate, insurance, or medical purposes. Then just some rewording. Colleges, universities, trade schools, business schools continue to be permitted. Federal, state, and local government offices, wording continues to be as is. The one use that I was proposing that we add, talk to the economic development manager about it, and there's no opposition to it. It's surrounded by industrial area, remember, as I showed you on the map, and that would be that we add R&D, research and development, as a permitted use within this district. That issue came up when Tarquette was considering bringing in their corporate headquarters, of course, which is going to be happening. And so I would suggest that we amend this to include research and development as a permitted use. It'll help to bring in some more types of office uses like that.
So would that be like number five, or would you be numbered?
Sorry.
So it would stand alone as a number that?
Yes. I think we would insert it as number four and then move that catch-all, which is number four,
sure,
down to number five.
I have another question.
Sure.
Okay, Rob, can you explain why on O1, when you refer to public and private educational facilities, and then on O2 it says specifically colleges, universities, trade schools, what's the purpose behind that rather than just using the same wording for both of those?
Well, the public and private educational facilities devoted to general learning and religious instruction, you know, would be like a private school, where what we're referring to under the O2 is higher level education, colleges,
okay,
universities, trade schools, business schools. So I thought they were different enough concepts that I didn't use the same wording.
Okay.
And then if there's no other questions, I'll The catch-all phrasing under the principal uses, any uses termed by the city of Solon to be substantially similar to any of the above listed uses. And I guess I should ask, is the commission approving the addition of R&D, or you want to think about it, or?
Are we going to specify what type of R&D, or are we going to just put research and development?
Well, I think it is something, I mean, any uses determined by the city of Solon, it's basically how it's done now. R&D is not listed as a permitted use necessarily under I-2 right now, although I think I have it in the amended version here. But I don't go into detail about what type of R&D. Now, there are prohibited uses about dangerous materials and those things, and that's in the last section of the code. That section's been reviewed by the fire department, and basically the same safety regulations we've had more or less all along. I wouldn't be specific on the R&D, but we would have protection against any hazardous uses.
That's what I was looking for, yeah. Especially when you're in an office building type.
Yeah, that was my concern as well. I didn't want to have a chemical lab in this district.
And I think the building code would also help in that area too. There are certain uses that wouldn't be compatible.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, accessory use.
I just want to be, just to be clear, how would you word this then?
I'd simply say research and development. Let me look at what I have in I-2. I think I listed it there, so I'd have to list it the same way. I just say under I-2, research and development facilities.
Okay.
Yep, so I'd use that exact wording.
Okay.
Okay, I'll move on to accessory uses. This is simply a matter of replacing some old boilerplate language with some new boilerplate language, so I'll read it quickly here. Any accessory use immediately and exclusively accessory to a use permitted on site, including automobile parking facilities, central heating, air conditioning, and maintenance facilities wholly enclosed within a permitted building, utilities, mechanical equipment, and or storage facilities wholly enclosed within a permitted building as necessary for the proper functioning of permitted uses. So that language would be removed. The standard wording would be added. I've read it before. I don't think you need me to read it again. So, same work.
Okay.
Yeah, good.
Sounds like a bedtime
story. I enjoy hearing you.
The prohibited uses are exactly what I had read for the last district. So, if you were fine with that.
Actually, Rob, they're slightly different. The prohibitions in the O1 and O2, at the O1, it doesn't speak to the parking and storage of vehicles, and in the O2, it's, and then the O2 doesn't speak to incidental retail. So it's
it's because let's see here, residential use. The wording should be the same. There shouldn't be a difference between. There's no difference that there would be a difference between prohibited uses in O1 and O2. So if there's an oversight there, I would go with the wording that we have in O1.
Okay. Well, it says O1.
Yeah, there is some in number 2. It is worded differently.
Yeah. Well, almost. That's quite.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, that says O1. That says O1, but item number 2 is different.
But your number 2 is not the same?
No.
Well, I would say that the number 2 in O2, which is obviously.
It is different.
Mm-hmm. And there's another.
In the commercial.
The O1, it's listing
yeah.
O1.
It's
if
listing
you look
O1,
here,
that's
it's supposed
how
to be O2.
Well, under
yeah.
item 2, it's different.
Yeah, so there's obviously a glitch in that section, which is obviously I'm glad you're reading it. That's why we're going through it. But I think I will want to reproduce this wording, the actual O1 wording.
And supplement O2.
Yeah, to the O2.
O2.
I'll verify that. The wording needs to be standardized. Whatever's used in the other prohibited use sections, I'll standardize that wording. I'm not sure where the glitch came from on that.
Okay, is the commission okay with that?
Yep.
Okay, well, I'm glad you caught that. Thank you. That's the office. That's the office districts. If there's any no questions on office districts, I'll move on to the commercial districts. And this gets a little different animal here, so we might have a little more discussion about this. We're on C1, we're going to go through C5, but once we get through these earlier districts, there'll be a lot of repetition. C1 is the historic district. That's the area along generally in the vicinity of Solon Road and in Bainbridge Road, and also extending down the Cruzy Drive and Bainbridge Road intersections. So the attempt here is, you see a lot of things crossed out in permitted uses. The attempt is to broaden the permitted uses, not restrict them. They're probably more strict than they need to be in that district right now. So it says principal uses, the following uses shall be permitted in accordance with the provisions of this ordinance. So these are struck through, but they're all reproduced in some form pretty much down below here. So offices, including those for professional business, real estate, insurance, or medical purposes, struck through but include below, preschools, funeral homes, museums, art galleries, similar uses, travel agencies, banks, and similar financial institutions, sit-down restaurants, personal service establishments, business services, including duplicating and printing. That one is not duplicated below, so you might want to consider whether you think printing and duplicating should be permitted uses in the C1 district, so that's something to consider. Then it says general retail uses, which the Planning Commission determines to be fully consistent with the purposes above. The new list of uses, again, with you'd have to determine if you how you feel about duplicating and printing. I thought that was maybe getting more into a to a industrial type use, not necessarily. If the I mean, it's a judgment call. The commission can go with it if they if you wish. New uses, retail sales such as clothing stores, electronic stores, houseware stores, jewelers, office supply stores, bakeries, food stores, etc. The food stores is important because grocery stores are actually prohibited and food sales are actually prohibited in C1 right now. Seems to me that in a historic commercial that a little shop selling specialty foods would be a type of use that you would want to have in the C1, so I'm adding that as a permitted use. Also, and I'm going to get into this again in the prohibited uses, I'm basically saying general retail is allowed. Under the prohibited use section, the existing prohibited use section in the C1 district says that general merchandise stores are not allowed. And I'm not sure why we would prohibit those, because the square footage is going to regulate. Maximum building size is 7,000 square foot per floor. So somebody doing a little bit of mixed retailing, I think, should be allowed in that district. So
something like the station.
Yeah.
The railroad station.
Yep. So we went through the retail. Then I so that's the retail sales. This is a retail service. It says retail services such as beauty shops, barbers, travel agents, photographers, insurance sales, etc. Businesses and professional offices, including medical and dental offices, just again the standardized wording. I'm afraid to say that after the last time I said it, but it's supposed to be standardized wording. Sit-down restaurants. This is an additional, and it's a new thing in the ordinance. Right now, only sit-down restaurants are allowed. Sit-down restaurants are defined under our code as you sit at a table, you order from a menu, and this is exactly how it's defined, and you eat on non-disposable dishes, and you know, it basically carry out and is not permitted with it. Casual restaurants, that's a term that's coming into use more. It's used, a lot of times called quick casual. Those are restaurants like Panera, Chipotle, things like that, where it's kind of a hybrid between true fast food. So you have a lot of people sitting down at tables, but you do have a certain amount of carryout taking place. So so that category has been created, the definition has been given for it, because I think, you know, like a lot of districts that we don't want fast food, you might want a Panera's in that district.
Excuse me for interrupting. How does the code differentiate between those two and fast food? Because
I can read fast food is something that's primarily oriented towards drive-through. Okay, what the distinction I'm making with the quick casual is it's maybe balanced towards sit down eating, but still we're going to have a major component carry out. So it is a fine distinction, but I think it's you know, you do get a lot of requests for specialty type restaurants, delis, things like that, you know, that I think you might want in these districts. So that category has been created to broaden the types of restaurants that are allowed. So you don't purely have to sit down and order from a menu and have a have a Elon dishes, or it's a use variance at that point. In other words, it's not legal in the city of Solon. You can't give a variance for it without a vote of the people. So that's kind of reproduced throughout these commercial districts. So obviously the commission can think about it. I mean, the definition that I have here, which I just say, restaurant casual, a restaurant primarily devoted to the immediate consumption of food within the building with customers seated at tables or counters, carry out service shall only be permitted as an incidental and minor use to the casual restaurant use. Casual restaurant use and drive-through service is prohibited. So a more heavy carry-out option element to it, again, not requiring you to eat on non-disposable plates, basically. Mm-hmm. So that's that. On the place again. Okay, so we were at casual restaurants, banks and other financial institutions, simply what's allowed there now reworded. Physical therapists, same types of uses that are allowed. Child daycare and preschools, exercise and fitness studios, pet shops, which the voters just put in. Funeral homes, museums, art galleries, similar uses. Again, very pretty much reproducing what's up above. And then any uses termed by City Solon would be substantially similar to any of the above listed uses. So if there's no more questions about permitted uses, I'll go on to the prohibited uses, because there's most of these, to accessory uses. This is attempting to standardize the wording that you've seen in the other districts for accessory uses. And it says, any use that is customarily incidental and accessory to any of the above listed permitted uses as determined by the City of Solon shall be allowed, crossed out, and permitted, substituted. Permitted on the same premises, crossed out, and lot added as the principal use subject to provisions of this chapter. These little changes are just meant to standardize between all the wording you've seen. All accessory uses except parking, mechanical equipment, and approved signage shall be wholly enclosed within the main building or other approved building. Now, a couple issues here in the prohibited uses. First of all, it says grocery stores are a prohibited use, and of course, I pointed out that we've added that as a permitted use because specialty stores.
You changed it to food stores, correct?
Food stores, correct. Mm-hmm. And these are small, the buildings in the historic district. They're small, and the biggest mm-hmm. one you can build new is 7,000 square foot floor area, so it'd be a specialty food store. Automobile sales, obviously, that's struck through, but still prohibited down below here. Hotels and motels, indoor-outdoor recreation, mixed general merchandise stores, video stores, furniture stores. I mean, a lot of these, I'm not sure why they're prohibited. So they're really like video store. First of all, I'm not sure. Are there video stores? The furniture stores, things like that. I don't think we need to be that specific and say certain types of retail are not allowed, because furniture sales, a little shop where they're selling handmade furniture might not be such a bad thing. So those are permitted now instead of prohibited. Game rooms, those are still prohibited under what I have. Commercial or personal warehousing or storage, except storage incidental to a permitted use, crossed out, but reproduced here is still a prohibited use. Any other use incompatible with permitted uses specified above or otherwise prohibited under Chapter 128903 of this code. The new wording that covers all this is here. It says prohibited uses within the C1 zoning district shall include, but are not limited to, the following. This list shall be considered to be supplementary to item A, principal uses, and item B, accessory uses of this chapter. So the prohibited uses, again, residential use of any building or premises. It's important that you have that in a commercial district that you actually list that. Gasoline sales, repair shops, including but not limited to auto repair and or servicing. Now, sometimes in these districts, you might have somebody doing like vacuum repair or something, but I'm just saying repair shops are not a permitted use. Automobile sales, fast food restaurants, because of the drive-through and the traffic, you wouldn't want that in a historic district. Contractor shops and landscape businesses, commercial self-storage businesses, tattoo parlors and or body piercing shops. Businesses selling products commonly used for drug paraphernalia. And these prohibited uses are reproduced pretty much throughout all the commercial districts. These are covering things that we've always said are prohibited in the city but not listed. businesses selling product commonly, gambling establishments, including but not limited to internet gambling businesses. This was written before the state really started cracking down, but I think we still need to have it in here. Pawn shops, thrift stores, consignment shops, or any other business substantially dealing in the acquisition and or resale of previously used goods. Dance clubs and live entertainment venues, outdoor amusement enterprises, arcades and game rooms, however amusement devices, such as you looked at tonight, subject to the provisions of the codified ordinances of the city of Solon, shall be permitted as an accessory use. Then it says laundry and dry cleaning shops are prohibited. Any use is determined by the city of Solon to pose a general nuisance or an imminent danger to the health, safety, welfare of the general public. Any use is determined by the city of Solon to be substantially similar to any of the above listed prohibited uses. So that's the boilerplate language we've been seeing.
The live music venue, would that be, if you had a restaurant there, would you be allowed to have live music as an ancillary use?
As an accessory use,
yes. As an accessory use, you'd be allowed to?
Yes.
So it seems a lot of these are on our prohibited uses list because they just wouldn't be feasible to fit in the footprints of the buildings or make it feasible for anyone to even try to put them in there in the first place, sounds like.
Probably a lot of them, but this same list is going to be, you'll find it reproduced as you get into C2, C3, because a lot of them, even if you could fit it in the building, maybe the pawn shops, you know, maybe drug paraphernalia sales, head shops, and I would think they probably would, might be a good district to go into for some, tattoo parlors. So we're saying it's not a permitted use. Let me make that clear. We're saying all those are not permitted uses in the C1.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The only one I see in there that I question is consignment shops,
mm-hmm.
gently used or clothing for resale. Generally, those are, we're looking at very small spaces to incorporate those. If you look at the communities around us where such shops exist, they're all usually very small. with a relatively high turnover of goods because they don't display them forever.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure that prohibiting that use and allowing the rest of the retail uses is a good idea.
You had to, if you were to take that out, you'd have to have a very good reason to differentiate between a consignment shop resale and pawn shop resale, mm-hmm. because the law is going to look at are they generally similar type activities, or generally similar things happening, and there has to be a legitimate government purpose if you're distinguishing between the two.
But a consignment shop, at least in my way of thinking, is not some place where I would go to take out a loan against something I left behind.
But Mr. Newberry, you're on a consignment shop. You're actually selling the goods to the, you're either A, selling the goods to the store and getting cash for it, or you're B, consigning it to them, which means that you're going to take a percentage of what they bring back, which is very, very similar to a pawn shop. Because a pawn shop, you can reclaim the goods. A consignment shop, you could also reclaim the goods if it doesn't meet the, if you set a reserve on it or if you do something like that. So I think it's very difficult for the city to differentiate between the two.
Okay. I guess I don't look at the two uses necessarily the same, and I think we need to find a way to allow the sale of gently used and reused clothing.
You could bring your clothes to a pawn shop if you wanted to.
Yeah, and there was a lot, just so...
Not you personally, but...
Nobody would want my rags.
I agree.
There was a lot of discussion with the law department on this specific wording, and the concern was that... that if you took out consignment shops, that discussion was had, then basically the distinction on the sale of second-hand goods is being made on the means by which they are acquired. And the feeling is you can't make that distinction. You can't say consignment is different from a thrift store, that they're the same general operation. But whatever the commission determines, obviously that can be discussed more because it's in every section of that we're going to mm-hmm. talk about from now on. So.
How about antiquing? You don't have anything here about antiquing.
Well, that is very perceptive. I was going to bring that up. It does say, that's right. I mean, the resale. That would be the biggest thing if there can be made a distinction for that you would want for antique shops. That is the resale of a good. And to be honest with you, I thought about that while this was being written and couldn't think of a way to make the distinction.
Because this is, in the historic district, this is the place where...
Mm-hmm.
And vintage clothing, too.
Yep.
It's big.
It's, that's something that we can maybe, maybe put a little more brain power to. Maybe the assistant law director and I can think about how that might, how, if that distinction can be made safely.
I have any brain left, yeah.
Am I killing the brain cells by doing this? So that is the prohibited uses. Any other questions on that for C1? Okay, moving on to C2. C2 is the zoning district where Uptown Solon is and in that general area. So I have a, I do have a question or two for you on that, on your opinion on something. The following uses shall be permitted in accordance with the provisions of this ordinance. Current list of uses is shopping centers, sit-down restaurants, professional and business offices, banks, savings and loan associations, and similar financial institutions, general retail uses except those prohibited below. So there's four or five things listed here. I'm expanding it out, okay, and proposing to expand the uses. So I'm going to read through the uses. Retail sales such as clothing stores, electronic stores, houseware stores, jewelers, office supply stores, bakeries, food stores. That's the standard wording that we're using. Retail services, again, the standard wording that I read for the C1 district, same wording. Then business and professional offices, including medical and dental offices, sit-down restaurants, which are all that are permitted right now. And then, again, the same issue with the C1, I'm adding casual restaurants, so you don't have to eat on the permanent plates, you can have some carry-out. The question that I have is, do you think fast food restaurants, considering the area, considering that it does allow shopping centers, obviously not something that you would need to answer tonight, maybe something you want to think about. Do you think fast food restaurants should be allowed in those areas too? I'm getting some faces that say, I don't think so.
I brought this question up, and then, you know, we're talking about C1 also. It's the biggest differentiation is that the drive-thru, is that the main driver?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, that would be the biggest difference, and the traffic that it generates.
But I mean, we have one here in Solon that's not a drive-thru that, you know, people...
True, the only one.
Right, probably in the state, but...
The reason I ask it is because his C2 obviously has Uptown Solon, so it has a shopping center there. The question is, do you think that out in front of that shopping center or in that area, is it appropriate or inappropriate to have the drive-through?
Are there any drive-through in that now?
No, not that far as I'm aware, at least.
Other than the bank.
Well, there's a bank drive. There is a drive-through.
Does Panera have any type of a drive-through?
No.
Yeah. No, they tried to pick up. They tried to use the back door for pickup, and it didn't work.
So, I mean, that might be something that you want to think about, whether you want to expand that into fast food restaurants or not. I think everybody agrees on the casual restaurants, I assume.
Right.
So I'm going to move on. Banks and other financial institutions, physical therapists, child daycare and preschools, exercise and fitness studios, pet shops, any use determined by the city is going to be substantially similar to any of the above listed uses. The accessory use language, again, I cringe to say it, it's supposed to be reproduced from everything from the same wording, so I'm not going to reproduce it again, not read it again. Okay. The question in the prohibited uses, I'm going to read through them what it says now, what would be struck through. Automobile sales or service struck through, but reproduced. Laundry and dry cleaning plants, except that pickup drop-off facility shall be permitted. Commercial or personal warehousing storing, except storage incidental to a permitted use. Contractor shops, indoor-outdoor sports recreation, except where clearly incidental to a permitted use. Religious or other places of assembly. Pet stores, gasoline service stations, drive-in service businesses. Any other use incompatible with the permitted uses specified above or otherwise prohibited under the chapter of this code. So those uses are struck through, but pretty much reproduced down here, and I would note if there was any differences. The only thing I'd point out is that the C1 district prohibits hotels and motels. The C2 district is a restricted commercial district. That's the name of that district. Should it list hotels and motels as a prohibited use within that section? So that would be another question that you might want to think over. The prohibited uses within the C2 district will be Exactly the same as what we had gone through C1. I'm just going to go through the first couple. Residential use of any building or premises, gasoline sales, repair shops, fast food restaurants. Is a prohibited use now. But remember, I brought up you might want to make it a permitted use. It's up to you. But this is the same as what we went through with C1. So to move this ahead, if you don't have any questions on that, I'll move on to the C3. Okay. C3 is our most permissive commercial district. It's basically the Somme Aurora area and along Aurora Road. Principal uses: the following uses shall be permitted in accordance with the provisions of this chapter. Any and all kinds of retail businesses, that's a real problem. That's why it struck through. Any and all is, when we go through the prohibited uses, you understand why that's a problem, because any and all is allowed. Sit-down restaurants, fast food restaurants, post offices, telephone exchanges, professional, private educational, private philanthropic, and private eleemosynary uses. If you can't pronounce the word, it shouldn't be in the zoning ordinance, probably, so we're taking that out. It's like a philanthropic.
Charitable organization.
Yep. The
from
new
the
list
1890s.
Of permitted. What's that?
From the 1890s.
Yeah. Somebody had a dictionary out when they were doing this one. So the wording is pretty standard between the commercial districts. The retail sales just list the same things every time we're listing retail sales. Retail services lists the same retail services that we've gone through before. Business and professional offices list the same as the other districts. This one says sit-down restaurants, casual restaurants, fast food restaurants. You would expect that because this is our most permissive commercial district. Banks and other financial institutions, physical therapists, child daycare, preschools, exercise and fitness studios, pet shops, post office, any use determined by city is only to be substantially similar to the above. So that's kind of the catch-all, everything that we would allow type zoning district. Accessory uses, that's the boilerplate language. Prohibited uses, and again, this would be the same as the prohibited use section that we went through with C2. It does not, to point out, it does not prohibit hotels or motels. Commission can decide whether you want to add that. Something that I would suggest when I'm looking at this that we should add to this district is that it should actually explicitly prohibit places of assembly, and not that I'm anti-religious, but it shouldn't allow religious services, because the reason is when you get religious services in a commercial district, it overwhelms, or any type of assembly use, it overwhelms the parking. So just so you know, places of worship are allowed in 75% of the city. They're allowed in all the residential areas, freestanding buildings, and they're allowed in some of the office areas. But you might want to say in the commercial districts, simply by the nature of the use, a large amount of people coming in at one time can overwhelm the retail parking. And you saw an example of that just recently.
What's the reason for the hotels, for not having the hotels?
I did not list hotels as a permitted or prohibited use.
If you mentioned it, so what would be the reason?
Hotels are large structures. They're tall. We do limit structure size to 35 feet, so it's not going to be that much different. Probably an aesthetics thing as much as anything in the commercial areas. It was a judgment call, and I think my judgment was I didn't have it in either list. Maybe I should have.
Well, because we're not going to see any hotels built like the Solon Motel anymore. They're going to be more like Spring Hill.
Correct.
Or the Hilton.
Yeah. There's a certain look you're going for in these downtown commercial areas. There's districts where hotels are explicitly permitted. They're explicitly permitted in the C5, which is along Enterprise Parkway, and they're explicitly permitted in C4, which is where the dealerships are up at the interchange area.
Right. Motor service. Actually, the dealerships are in C3.
No, the dealerships are in C4 because it's motor service commercial. It's actually the only district that allows them.
Would you like a rebuttal?
Did we change this?
Would you like a rebuttal, Mr. Hoover?
No, I just.
Yeah, it's C4. Other than that, the prohibited uses are the same, so I will move on to the next. Mm-hmm. Thing, which will be very easy and getting more less and less painful for you. If you need me to stop at any point, I'm trying to make it to C5 tonight, which we're getting close. So, C3A, that, this is the Giant Eagle zoning. The old wording was, you know, retail businesses, including retail services such as dry cleaners, travel agents, beauty salons, bakeries, but accepting gasoline stations shall be only permitted as an accessory use. Any other uses otherwise prohibited within this code, ordinance shall be prohibited in the C3A. Sit-down restaurants, again, these are permitted uses, fast food restaurants, post offices, businesses and professional offices, hotels. So those are all, the hotels are not reproduced below, so I'm pointing that out in the C3A. It's treated like the C3. It's not listed, and I'm going to make note of these and come back to them at a future meeting, where we get some more direction on what needs to be added. This list of permitted uses is the same as the C3 permitted uses, so we don't need to go through that again. The accessory uses.
They have dry cleaners in here twice.
What's that?
They have dry cleaners in here twice, one in part of 2 and one in 12.
Two, such as dry cleaners.
Okay,
I see what you're saying. Yeah. Yep. Okay, we'll strike out, because the standard wording is 2.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
We'll strike out 12 in that section.
Good.
Yep.
Got one.
Okay, and then accessory uses are a little different in this section because the gas station issue, so I'm going to read through it. Any use that is customary incidental accessory to any of the above listed permitted uses shall be, as determined by the City of Solon, shall be allowed. I'm not going to read that whole thing because that's the boilerplate
mm-hmm.
language. The different language is no approved accessory building shall be or shall exceed 3% of the square footage of the main building. That was to tie it in with the get-go was specifically envisioned under this, because this zoning was written explicitly for the for that use. It says gasoline station, one gasoline station permitted as an accessory use per C3A shopping center project, but only as a directly affiliated subsidiary of the principal anchor tenant within the shopping center.
Mm-hmm.
Again, get-go being a subsidiary of Giant Eagle. Prohibited uses are exactly the same as the C3 district we just went through. There was a mistake here. I have it crossed out in my version here. The version you have in front of you does not show this crossed out. That's the existing wording. So the existing prohibited use wording is replaced with the boilerplate prohibited wording with the drug paraphernalia, all that good stuff.
So we should cross ours out.
Yes, that section was a mistake. That should this 1 and 2 immediately under C should be crossed out. And if there's no questions on C3A, we'll move on to C4, just one district away from the end here. C4 just modified the permitted uses a little bit. Following uses shall be permitted in accordance with the provision of this ordinance, gas stations, which are currently allowed, automobile sales, because this is the motorist service commercial district, so automobile sales are allowed. But I did add this, which is important. I say we're not more than 25, automobile sales were not more than 25% of monthly sales volumes consist of pre-owned vehicles. That's important. That's how dealerships operate. But in the prohibited use section, which we're going to get to next week, it explicitly prohibits used car sales. So I'm proposing to take that out of the prohibited use section. Say within the C4 where automobile sales occur that you can sell used cars. I mean, they're all dealerships sell some certain volume of used cars. I'm saying that should not exceed 25% of monthly sales.
We put that in there, Rob. We put that in there, but we're putting something in there that we can't enforce, really. I mean, how are we going to know whether it's 20%, 32%, 40%? Or 28%.
It's like a lot of sections of the code. You're right. I mean, you're absolutely right. Let's say like a home business. A home business is allowed to occupy a certain percentage of a home. You only go to enforce that when you have a serious problem and you use it. It's better to have the language. The cure might be worse than the problem, because if you take that out, then car sales are permitted, and you could get just a used car lot, which I assume people would not want. I think they're okay with the dealerships that we have, but I don't think you want to just say just used car lots are allowed in the city. So this was a striking that happy balance, allowing the dealerships, the big dealerships to exist, while putting some measurable restriction on the amount of used car sales. And if the assistant law director wants to think it over and come up with some stronger wording, I'm certainly all open to that.
I think this may need some work, but I also am curious about what's the volume? Is it volume by units, volume by dollars?
Yeah. I mean,
volume by amount of space?
I was thinking by vehicles, by number of vehicles.
But are we really going to, we're putting something in a code with permitted uses, and are we really going to, I mean, it's just, I understand it's going to be on a probably a complaint-only basis, mm-hmm. but it's going to be in the code. We're not going to, obviously, we're not going to be sending our zoning inspector out to count cars, are we?
Well, I think if you got into a situation where you, I mean, first of all, this is built on the premise that you don't want used full-blown used car lots.
Right.
And if you don't want full-blown used car lots, then there's going to have to be some percentage or some measurement.
Why can't we just put no used car lots? Why can't we just do that and just have it ancillary or a secondary use to the new car lot?
Well, then you're implying a percentage at that point, because you're implying 50%, I suppose, because or 49%, because if it's you're saying that a new car lot is something that predominantly sells new cars. And that the used cars can be an accessory to the new car, so it's going to be a percentage regardless. I think this, and I agree with you 100%. This is, and was well aware of it when I was writing this section. What I'm thinking of in my mind, and the commission, you know, obviously might have a different opinion, but a new car sales is going to be about 75% new cars and about 25%. Used cars. That's what I'm presuming. I mean, we could do more research. I could talk to the assistant law director about some addition from better wording if you'd like. But I think the percentage either going to be specifically stated in the ordinance, or we're going to be assuming it in our mind while we're enforcing it one way or the other. Lon and I will talk a little bit more about this. Hotel, it just said motels before, so I put hotels and motels are permitted uses. Sit-down restaurants, casual restaurants added. Fast food restaurants was already permitted, so the casual restaurant's kind of a no-brainer. Business and or medical offices, any use determined by the city of Solon to be substantially similar to any of the above-listed uses. Accessory uses, pretty much the same wording as it is. I just put in additional wording to get the standardized wording that we're using. So that's all this is. It's the same stuff. This is existing wording for that district. Basically allows for some engine repairs, but in association only with the dealership. Prohibited uses, just the standard language that we use for prohibited uses. If you beg me, I'll read through it, but otherwise I'll move to the next section, because you've heard it all before. And the final one we wanted to get through tonight was the C5 industrial retail. In service permitted uses, this is the zoning along Enterprise Parkway. Black is existing wording. As you can see, most of this is existing wording, mainly because we just revised this within the past year or so, and a lot of this wording was used to write all the other sections of the code with the standardized wording. I just added casual restaurants, fast food, casual restaurants, sit-down restaurants. Standardized wording here. Accessory uses is just the standardized wording that we went through with all accessory uses. Prohibited uses, it simply takes the existing wording that was just voted on and standardizes it to the code. So this is the same wording that you had in C2, C3, C3A, C4, just reproduced in C5. So if there's no question, or if you have any questions, that's all the sections I was going to review tonight.
Just one comment that it's interesting in C5 that you struck out others or similar overnight lodging establishments.
Okay.
That was added into that section of the code specifically to allow youth hostels, which don't fit in as hotels and motels.
Oh, okay.
Never developed that way, but that's why it was there.
Very interesting. So that's those are the true commercial districts. At the next meeting, if there's no questions, at the next meeting I'll go through the industrial districts. I'm lumping C6, which surprisingly is the zoning where Marks and Sears is, but you'll see why when I go through that I'm lumping it in with an industrial, because it's very much like an industrial zoning district. But we'll cover those districts and finish out the review next week, or next meeting, and then do our cleanup and hopefully send it to council in a few weeks or a month or so.
Okay. All right, thank you, Rob. Any questions for Rob from the commission? Seeing none, what we'll do at this point is we'll open up the public hearing, reopen the public hearing. We never closed it, yeah. So is anyone here, would anyone like to comment on any of the provisions of the proposed zoning code? Sir, please come up and state your name and address for the clerk. Thank you.
My name is Huijie Chen. I live in the 32136 South Roundhead Drive. And last month, I heard the news about the zoning change, and I wrote an email to Mr. Perninus about the number of non-agricultural animal to be kept at home. I don't know, last week, last discussion, I missed it, so I just come out and say, asking what's the result from last discussion. And did you mention about what I discussed, concerned to you?
Yes, yes. And Rob, if you'd like to just, this gentleman I did speak with, he lives in my ward, and he wanted to know about the chickens or hens and how many he's allowed to have. And I like you to just explain to him briefly.
Right. Right now, we're taking input in emails like you sent and that are being considered. The ordinance is purely a draft right now. It says two chickens. I think it's going to probably end up being higher than that. Mm-hmm. Basically, the last couple of meetings, we've been taking input on what types of animals to allow, and the commission will be considering all that input and your input at the future meetings. Before anything is passed, I'll go through it line by line on the screen like I did here tonight.
Mm-hmm. Well, so I just want to add that I want you to know, Truck Supply asking if they change their requirement to buy six chick at the minimum, and they saying they did not change it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I mean, six chick just almost like in a six-pack box, mm-hmm. has a lot of room still, and you are required to, it's a kind of, I think it's a...
I think what this gentleman said when I spoke with him on the phone is that you have to buy the animals in a minimum quantity, and he said six, was it?
Six, yeah.
Six is the order.
Actually, right. Some that can sell you three, and you can buy them individually, but six is normal.
They cannot sell you three.
Meyer's Hatchery sells you three.
You need about six or above. Okay. And also, this also written in the cities, in the Solomon's cities ordinance, you need to have a six or more if you want to give away. You cannot give a three to someone else. It was against the city's law.
Okay.
And this is on the city's law already.
And you purchase them where? Where do you purchase yours?
Truck Supply in the Medina.
Okay.
Never guess it. I agree.
All right. That's my comment.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay.
And then we'll be in touch.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you for coming.
There, the one thing I found out about the husbanding animals on a residential lot in the last since the last meeting is I happened to talk to a member of the Planning Commission in Cleveland Heights who just went through this process about a year and a half ago to determine what the correct number was and how to adjudicate it. Their ordinance is very similar to what the City of Cleveland came up with. Although, because the lots in Cleveland Heights are typically bigger, they adjusted the size, but not the numbers. Another source to look at.
Okay, and we're lucky, sir, that we have a planning director who does know a lot about chickens and agricultural animals. So,
yep.
Anything further from any member of the public? Seeing nothing, we will keep the hearing open for our next meeting. At the next meeting, we will do the same procedure. Mr. Franklin will go through the remainder of the amendments, and then we will open it up again for public comment or keep it open for public comment and encourage the comments on that. Next item, minor alterations from the Planning Department. Rob.
Okay, four items tonight, and the first is dealing with Raptite, 6075 Cochran Road. simply on, this little L comes out on the building. They simply want to add a window in that area, way off of the road, not a problem, and would be situated, well, you can't see it, but it'd be situated right there, and I don't imagine anybody's opposed to a window.
Any opposition to this?
No.
Okay, thank you, Rob.
Thank you, and then Carnegie Corporation, 6180 Cochran Road, proposing to add some mechanical equipment outside. This is this building right here, which sits way off of Cochran Road. They simply want to add three air conditioning units along this side of the building. They're not going to be visible. They're adding some mechanical louvers and that in the area. Again, not got this big building in front of it. You're not going to see it. Okay.
Any problems or comments? Okay.
The next issue is the rebuilding of the bank building on Cruzy Drive. And we talked about this a little bit in caucus, so I'll go over it here again and explain the rationale behind this. They're trying to rebuild the bank with the same materials that were that the bank has always had. The issue is in 1999, when the bank was built, the areas here under the eaves were approved as wood siding. They were always AZAC. AZAC is a PVC type material. They're simply asking for approval to come in and redo these areas with the AZAC again. AZAC is currently not a permitted use. It was permitted at the time that it was built. Now, granted, they didn't build it in accordance with the ABR, but permits were issued by the city, inspections were done, and that AZAC type material was approved in 1999. So we're suggesting that it be approved again today, even though it's not a permitted use today. It's consistently been AZAC since 99.
Any questions or comments?
No, it's just, I think that's a better material for that application.
Yeah, less maintenance.
And less hazard.
Yeah.
Anything further, Rob?
Not on that. One more issue.
Sorry, they've got a drywall.
That is on 31225 Bainbridge Road. Which is one of the Davis buildings. And on the back of the building facing 422, there is an overhead garage door at that address. And they simply want to brick it in with materials that are the same as what's there now. And that is?
Yep.
Any comments, issues, concerns? Okay, thank you, Rob.
Thank you.
Move on to comments from the commission, starting with the mayor.
Thank you. I do have a few comments tonight. First, I just want to say congratulations to Dan and Amy Calk, who hosted our 11th Fun Fest this past weekend. Again, it was an extremely successful event, very well attended. Everyone really had a great time. And also just to say thank you to the masses of volunteers who helped them keep this program going strong. It serves such a great purpose, and but they do such a wonderful job for the community, so I just really wanted to you know, give a shout out to those two. Also, secondly, another big congratulations to the Solon girls track and field team for winning their third straight title at the state indoor track and field championship this past weekend as well. They're another incredible team, and so I'm sure we'll be seeing more of them in the regular track season coming up. Third, on Friday, March 21st, the Solon Center for the Arts is hosting the Drew Murray Magic Show at 7:30 p.m. in the Calvetta Brothers Floor Show Theater. Every person who buys a $10 ticket to this show will receive a $10 gift certificate to Station 43. So as they're describing it, it's kind of free, if you want to look at it that way. So tickets can be purchased in person at Solon Center for the Arts, or you can purchase them online at solonarts.org. Also, another event for Solon Center for the Arts that's coming up is the Focus 2014. That is our photography event that we hold every year. This is going to be the ninth annual Focus event. Registration deadline for Focus is March 15th. And you can applications can be downloaded off the city website. So just want to make sure people are aware of that deadline. And then finally, on Tuesday, March 18th, the Solon Historical Society will present the Cleveland Memory Project, which is a major online repository of photos, ebooks, audio interviews, and videos on the history of Greater Cleveland and Northeast Ohio. And that program begins at 7:30 p.m. And those are all my comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Newberry?
There's no way I can follow that.
Bentley?
Well, we are, what is today, is a Tuesday, we're halfway through our OGTs at the high school. So everyone, you students get up early and get a good breakfast before you head out to take your test in the morning, and good luck. Thank you.
No, I said Mr. Bentley.
Oh, I didn't see what you said.
You just knew it was your turn.
Exactly.
Okay, is that it?
Yes,
okay.
Thank you.
I have nothing. Mr. Franklin?
No comments.
Lon?
No comments.
No comments.
Councilman from Ward 4?
No comments.
No comments.
Jeff?
No comments.
Carrie?
No comments.
Okay, comments from the audience? Seeing none, entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mayor Drucker?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Mr. Polonis?
Yes.